I welcome you all to this webinar on data science with Python. On behalf of entire family of Cognixia, I would like to thank you all for joining this webinar. And this is Hemant, and I'm going to be the presenter for today's webinar. And we are right on time, and thanks for the overwhelming response. I can see already hundreds of participants have joined the webinar so far, and still I'm continuously getting the notification for new and new joiners. So great. We are going to have a great session today. Just one quick announcement that we are going to wait for another 5 minutes or something so that, you know, remaining folks can join us, and then we will start. Okay, so be online and we are going to join in next 5 minutes. Thank you. Hey, hello everyone. This is Hemant. I'm back, and thank you all who have joined recently. And I think we have very good audience to start with today's webinar. And I would again like to thank you all for joining this webinar on data science with Python. And I would like to thank you all on behalf of Cognixia for joining this session. I hope you are going to enjoy this session. There is going to be too much to learn from this session, especially for those who are, you know, looking for pursuing a career in the fields of data science and machine learning in near future. So wish you all the best, and looking forward for your help and support to make this webinar a success. Okay, so having said that, let us go ahead and start with today's session. And before we start with the actual content, actual topics that we are going to cover today, I would like to request you all that you can feel free anytime to post your questions, your queries regarding the session, regarding the topics that we are going to cover in today's session. So anytime you feel any query, any question, anything which is not clear, please feel free to ask your question in the chat window with the help of chat option. I will be regularly checking the chat window, and I will finish the current topic that I would be covering at that point in time. And right after completing, right after finishing that topic, I will pay attention towards all the questions and queries and will try to answer all the questions and queries in time. Okay, so great. I think everyone should be good. Please let me know if we are good to go ahead. Okay, and we can simply start with today's session. Okay, great. Great for your response. Thank you, everyone. And let's go ahead and start with today's session. Okay, and I'm already, you know, getting some questions regarding scope, regarding, you know, programming languages and everything. So I would like to request you, please have little patience. You know, all of your questions are going to be, all this type of questions especially are going to be covered for sure. We have already included all this type of information in today's agenda. Definitely that is going to be the, you know, scope of today's session. So like what to study, what not to study, which programming language, Python, R. So, you know, we can, we are going to cover everything in today's session. So don't worry. And we are going to cover all these questions. And specifically, if you think your particular question, your specific query is there, which is not covered yet related to the topic, then you can definitely feel free to post your query or questions in the chat window. Okay. Okay, great. So let's go ahead. And firstly, we are going to start with today's agenda. Like what is going to be the today's agenda? What exact topics, what exact, you know, areas we are going to touch in today's webinar. So firstly, we are going to start with some very, very important and very, very critical questions. Okay. So we would like to make you comfortable with. Okay, so firstly, we will make you comfortable with what is actually data science. Okay, so many times, you know, we have already, sometimes we see we have already started working on data science. We have already started learning machine learning, deep learning, but exactly a question is still there in our mind. Exactly what I'm learning, what is the scope, what is included, what is not included, what is the exact definition of machine learning, what is the exact definition of data science. So, you know, still people have don't have, you know, that clarity what exactly is data science. So in the first topic for today, we are going to clear that question. We are going to clear that doubt. Exactly what is data science? So we are going to have a very good, very detailed discussion about this question. Followed by that, we will cover some very important question regarding the aspiration, regarding your aspiration, regarding your way, your to the journey of data science. So many a times, you know, once you decided like, yeah, I would like to pursue my career in data science or machine learning, the next question that comes to your mind is what do I need to learn? Okay, am I eligible for data science or not? Okay, so we are going to cover, you know, all this type of thing, like what is data science toolkit, what exactly you need to learn, what is the prerequisites if there are any, and who is more suitable to get into data science. Definitely, you know, it is not something that everyone who would like to get into data science can do it. Yeah, everyone can do it with determination, with dedications, right? But yeah, who can be the pupil? Who are the most eligible pupil? Who are the most suitable candidates for the data science, for to get into data science, to get into machine learning? So we are going to talk about all those things, and at minimum what is needed. Okay, so even I'm interested, my profile, my previous background is not matching, but what is minimum, what is the minimum requirement, what is the minimum criteria to get into data science and machine learning? So we will talk about, you know, all these things. Followed by that, we will also talk about little you know, technical and conceptual aspects of data science and machine learning. So we will start then with CRISP DM model, a very famous, a very round model for data science project implementation. It talks about all the phases, tasks and activities which are included throughout the data science project journey. So we will talk about that model. We will see what different phases, tasks and activities are executed while working on a data science project, because sometimes, you know, that is also a very big question, which particular thing is performed at what time, right? So many a times we know, like, we need to do machine learning, we need to do data analysis, we need to do this and that and that, but how to stitch all these things together? What is going to be the proper flow? What is going to be the proper step-by-step approach? Okay, so CRISP DM model talks about that approach in quite detail. Followed by that, we are going to talk about Python. So we have multiple options available. So what are the properties or what are the main advantages of Python we have, which makes Python better than other programming language? Okay, so that is going to be something for today's session, and let us go ahead and start with today's session. Okay, and I can see there are some questions already, like what is the difference between AI and machine learning from Vedant. So Vedant, I would like to, you know, keep this question for the latter part of the session. I hope your question will already is going to be answered already, you know, at the end of the session. Okay, so let us go ahead and start with today's session. I hope you are able to you know, hear me properly without any problem, without any noise or disturbance. If anytime you feel, you know, my voice is not clear or you are facing some challenges with clarity or noise, then please let the support team know, let me know, and that's it. Okay, so let's go ahead and start with today's session. Thanks Sumit for your quick confirmation, and we are going to start with today's session now. Okay, so that is going to be the first question for today. What is data science? Okay, so what is data science? Very, very important question. Many a times this question is asked, and many a times, you know, I have seen people are not able to answer this question properly. You won't believe me, but whatever number of candidates, aspirants I have met so far, I have asked this question, hardly no one was able to answer this question precisely. And believe me, I'm not talking about the technical definition. I'm asking about the explanation. Okay, in very layman language, in very practical language, no theoretical definition or nothing. But yes, many time it happens, you know, we already know what is machine learning, we have actually worked on a couple of models as well. Okay, but still we are not able to answer this question. Okay, so let us try to make sure firstly we understand what is exactly data science. Okay, and believe me, if you are going to attend any interview in future, and most often, you know, this question is asked for as a first question in the interview, like what do you understand by data science? Okay, and believe me, if you are able to answer this question precisely, your half of the interview is already done. You can impress the interviewer if you answer this question precisely, if you answer this question perfectly. That is why this question, understanding the exact definition of data science, is really important. Okay, so let's go ahead with this question for today. And data science is basically a data-driven science, but there are two things. Okay, here we have data as well as we have science. So we will have to clearly understand the integration of data and science together. Then only we will be able to understand what is data science. Okay. Firstly, if I go through the definition of data science, and you can find this type of definition online available in the video, in the books, in the websites. It is an interdisciplinary field about scientific methods, processes, systems to extract knowledge, insight from data present in various format, either structured or unstructured. Right. This was all about the definition. But let us try to understand this definition with some real example, with some explanation behind that. Okay, so as I mentioned earlier, data science is not about a particular domain. Data science is not about a particular technology. Data science is not about a particular tool, or data science is not about a particular data as well. Okay, so its scope is very wide. Its scope is not limited at all, and over the period of time, its scope is growing and further growing. Okay, so any area, any project where you play with the data, where you are having data coming from different sources, from your decision making system of the organization, and you apply some scientific method. When I say scientific methods, or when I say science, then science is the superset of everything. Okay, science, if you talk about tools, about the IDEs, about the programming languages, everything is under science. If you talk about statistics, mathematics, probability, algorithm, everything is science, right? If you talk about some programming languages like Python, R, some IDEs, anything, so everything is science. So basically, when you apply all these science present in any format at the top of data, present in any format, and your objective is going to extract some insights. And when I say insights, it is not the normal conclusion. It is not the aggregation. I'm not talking about the business intelligence where you simply aggregate the things, sum up the things, roll up the things, slice up, slice down. Okay, so no. So here we are talking about the insights. Okay, and there is a very big difference between, conclusion and insights. Insight is something which cannot be driven by the regular BI or by the regular analytics approach. So again, when you combine the data present in any format, science present in any format, available in any format but relevant to data science, and then you combine these two things in order to retrieve insights, which is not obvious type of insights, then it is data science. Okay, so very clear, very basic, and very simple definition. Okay, data present in any format, science represented by anything, any tool, any technology, any theorem, any technique that you can apply at the top of data, and then you can retrieve the insights out of the data, then it is nothing but data science. And Aditya, I'm going to answer all this type of questions, definitely in that later part of the session. So I would request you all, if we can be a little relevant and ask the questions related to the topics that we are going to cover at the end of the session. If you think, something which you want to ask is not all answered already, then definitely please feel free to ask your questions. But we will go ahead, in a very planned manner. We have already designed the content of this webinar with all the precautions to make sure we are going to cover all this type of very common and very important questions. Okay, so let's go ahead with the rhythm of this webinar, and then you can raise your questions once the topics have been covered and you think my question is not already covered. Okay. So, okay. Thank you. So now let's go ahead and talk about some more explanation about data science. Okay. So like what can be the data and what can be the science? Okay. Further, what can be the further explanation behind data and science? Okay. So data, you know, is everywhere. Everything is generating data. Now we are living in the world of IoT. We are wearing the devices. We are having the devices which are generating data. You know, even nowadays, it is hard to manage our personal data. We are actually generating too much data, even at our personal level, that, you know, sometimes we have to struggle to find our old pictures, videos, okay, like, so it is not managed. Then you can imagine what sort of or what level of problems organizations are facing nowadays. They have data in petabytes. It is very hard to, you know, manage that data at all. At that point in time, you are talking about making sense out of the data, right? So that is the biggest question. Organizations are not able to manage their data. Then how you can expect to make sense out of data? So definitely the regular, the traditional BI technologies are not the answer. We are living in the world of big data. We are living in the world of enormous data where, you know, too much data is being generated at exponential rate on each and every day. And this rate is increasing every day, day by day. Okay, so that is the biggest thing. And not only, you know, the size of the data, which is a challenge nowadays, but the structure of the data. So we are not only having the structured data or formatted data, but nowadays we are going to have unstructured data as well. And when you talk about the images, when you talk about the audio, video, you know, all type of XML data, HTML data, which is not present in the form of like a tabular structure in the form of row and column, right? So this type of data is also available. Unstructured data, semi-structured data. And this data is also equally important. This data is also very critical for the business because it has got some very good insights. Data is equivalent to information and information is equivalent to business. If you are ignoring the data, you are ignoring the business. You are ignoring the revenue. Definitely, organizations and companies cannot ignore their business. They cannot ignore their revenue. That is why data is also known as new oil nowadays. Okay, because data is equivalent to business. Okay, so having said that, okay, we all agree. We have too much data. Data is growing exponentially. We have big data technologies to manage that data. But big data technologies like Hadoop or other environment platforms, they are not able to support you with your advanced analytics. They can manage the data. They can store the data. They can retrieve the data when you query it, right? But we are talking about the insights. And when you say insights, then big data technologies or traditional analytics or business intelligence, they are helpless. Okay. Now we will have to talk about another variety or another range of science that can be applied at the top of this enormous data, and it can actually produce the insights for you. So we are talking about that science. Business intelligence, analytics, regular analytics, visualization, these are also science, right? These are also the approaches which are used to retrieve the information, to retrieve the knowledge out of data, but not the insights. We are talking about insights. We are talking about some information or some conclusion that definitely cannot be made available with the help of regular BI or traditional approaches. Okay. So having said that, what this science include? So this science is going to include some concepts, some theories, some techniques from the range, from the discipline, like mathematics, statistics, information science, computer science. Okay, so there is no particular definition. There is no particular scope. Basically, science is everything. So from any subdomain of science, whether it is statistics, whether it is probability, whether it is computer science, whether it is information science, anything, any subdomain of science from where you can utilize some theories, some techniques, some algorithms, some knowledge at the top of the data in order to retrieve the insight. And that insight is going to be not traditional insight, but something which is special, something which cannot be predicted, something which cannot be answered, which cannot be made available by the traditional BI, then that is data science. Okay. Now, particularly from the computer science, from the mathematics, from the statistics, data science is going to involve some very special subdomains like machine learning. Okay, some states related algorithms from the areas of classification, association, cluster analysis, data mining, forecasting, visualization, time series analysis. So there are too many specific subdomains of stats and mathematics which are really important nowadays, which are really playing very important role nowadays in order to retrieve these insights out of data. Okay, so that is something which is data science. So here at the top of data, you will apply something which is not ordinary, which is not traditional. Okay, you will apply some science which is not the traditional science, but it is coming from the subdomain of machine learning. It is coming from the subdomain of statistics, mathematics, probability, specifically like clustering, regression, association, cluster, this type of science when you employ at the top of data in order to retrieve some very informative information out of the data, that is data science. Okay, so in short, data science is all about data plus science, which is not the traditional science. We are talking about the machine learning related science, and then you retrieve, then you convert this data, or then you abstract the knowledge or insight out of data which cannot be made available by traditional BI technologies. Okay, so that is nothing but data science. And now I'm going to have a look at some questions that we have got so far. So let me find if we have some relevant question from this particular topic. So okay, does data mining techniques are used in image processing? Yes. So I'm not sure I got your correct name, but yes, data mining and data science. So data mining is nothing but the origin of data science. So, and not only in the image processing area, but all the areas of data science, we include data mining principles. Then Swaroop is asking, insight can be anything other than information or facts. Swaroop, insights generally is represented in the form of information. When you say information, it includes everything. Fact is also a form of information. Some visual representation is also a form of information. Some prediction is also a form of information. So information is very wide definition. So when you employ any data science technique at the top of data, ultimately you will get some output. Maybe visual output, maybe textual output, maybe sometimes only the answers, but we cannot say it is going to be other than information. It is always going to be information, but particularly it can have it can be in any form. Okay, then Pranay is saying, what kind of application use machine learning in the industry? So Pranay, we have a wide range of applications. So we cannot talk about a particular type, like what type answering this question will be too generic. Okay, so all sort of machine learning algorithms, that I could remember, I have seen those applications, I have seen those algorithms, I have seen those models being implemented in almost all sort of industry. Okay. Aditya is saying difference between machine learning and deep learning. Aditya, machine learning and deep learning can be segregated in two classes by the boundary where we rather than making conclusion on the structured data, when we start making conclusion on some unstructured data as well. So for example, audio processing, video processing, image processing, generally, deep learning will talk about this type of unstructured data. Second thing, in machine learning, we will talk about supervised, unsupervised sort of machine learning approaches where we are supposed to make the prediction based on the data by training the model. Okay, here in deep learning, your model, your algorithm will learn about the data, will learn about the pattern on its own. That's why it is also known as like reinforcement learning. So that is the biggest difference. And how do we deploy machine learning models into the production server? A very generic question. Generally, in short, machine learning models are deployed in the form of sometime APIs, in the form of some applications. So there are many, applications available like RShiny, Django. So with the help of which you can create an application and then data science or machine learning solution can be used by the end users in the form of application. Okay, could you give me more detailed knowledge rather than common generalized information and definition? So Ritu, we have just started with the session, so please have some patience and definitely we are going to come up with too much detail. Okay, so I'm getting too much questions and I will have to stop the Q&A for this particular side here, otherwise we will not be able to maintain our rhythm. Okay, so let's go ahead and start with the subsequent areas that we are going to cover. So the second thing we are going to talk about is what you need to learn, because I'm getting many questions related to that, like exactly what I need to learn, what is better, what is best. So let's talk about all those things which are going to be required while working on a data science project. Okay, so basically a data science project is executed in a phase-wise manner. So you start with the collection and with the analysis of data, then you start working on data exploration, followed by that a machine learning implementation, then deployment. So basically a traditional data science project is executed in 4, 5, 6 phases, one after another. If you are working on a complete data science use case which is going to employ all these phases, then you will notice that we start a traditional data science project right after the requirement gathering. We start, I'm talking about the technical aspects, okay? So we start the technical aspects of data science project from data engineering. So we perform data engineering. It is also known as data pre-processing. Followed by that, we perform data analysis. We use some statistics and probability-related concepts to perform some inferential analysis to make sense out of the data, to make sure our data is present in the way it is supposed to be for the given machine learning model implementation. Followed by that, we support our finding, we support our analysis in the form of visual analytics, in the form of interactive and visual representation. Then we implement machine learning. Okay, so these are going to be some traditional steps. Let us talk about all the technologies, all the tools that you are going to use at each and every phase, in each and every phase of data science, starting with the data engineering. Okay, so what is data engineering? Data engineering is nothing but starting from the initial collection of the data, then you process that data, you make the data in the form that it can be utilized by your machine learning model. Okay, raw data cannot be given or cannot be provided to the machine learning model as it is. You will have to perform a lot of data engineering at the top of data in order to make it in the form so that your machine learning model can read this data. So that is all about data engineering. You collect the data, you process process it, you transform it, you know, all the ETL type of things you do with the data in this particular phase until it becomes in the required format. Okay, so what do we do in the, what techniques, what technologies or what tools exactly we use in this particular phase? So we can use any statistical programming language like Python, R or SAS to perform this type of data engineering stuff. But when you are dealing with large data, then I would prefer, or generally it is preferred, to have some traditional ETL or big data tool. Okay, so like ETL is nothing but extract, transform and load. So you must be, many of you must be comfortable, we will be aware of some ETL tool like Informatica, right? So this type of, or Talend, and there are many. So basically, you know, this type of ETL tools are used to extract the data, to transform the data and finally load it in the form so that it can be present in the required format or at the top. Or again, you know, if you are working in a big data environment, then you will use the big data technologies like the MapReduce concept, or you can also use Hive in order to further, you know, make the query at the top of your big data stored in HDFS. So basically, you know, all this type of stuff you do in order to make your data available in the format, in the abstract format, in the one header format, so that it can be made available in the format, it can be used by the machine learning model. Okay, so data engineering is all about that. So question is, which one is better? Okay, so I would say definitely if you are working on huge data, definitely if you are playing with the high volume of data, I would not prefer any statistical tool like Python, R or SAS, because they are not meant for that. Data engineering sometimes can be too complex job to be handled by some statistical tool. So a statistical tool like Python and R will not give you that much performance, that much efficiency, and definitely the better option is to use some ETL, to use some big data platform to process this enormous amount of data. Coming to the next step, which is data analysis. Now, once the data is available, okay, in the form that can be used by the further processing, you perform the data analysis on your data. And sometimes data analysis is started in parallel along with data engineering as well. Okay, and generally data analysis is started even before data engineering, because as soon as you start working on a project, you start understanding the business, you start understanding the domain functions, as soon as right after that you start understanding your data as well. But when you perform data analysis from the data science point of view, there are some specific methods, there are some specific approaches which are used by data scientists in order to understand the data better from the project objective point of view. And those some of those very standard methods are like exploratory data analysis. Exploratory data analysis is nothing but exploring your data and making sure your data is available in the format, or your data is actually available for the given use case. It should not be the case like whatever use case or whatever project you are going to implement, your data is not in sync with the objective. Okay, so you can say there can be two type of objective behind an exploratory data analysis. So exploratory data analysis makes sure we have correct data available. Okay, second thing is our data is available in correct format. Okay, so having the correct data as well as having the correct data in correct format is all about exploratory data analysis. It is also referred as EDA. And a statistical tool like Python, R, SAS, they are perfect choice to perform this type of exploratory data analysis. That is why from here we start seeing the preference is given to Python, R and SAS, this type of a statistical tool. On a comparison basis, I would say Python, R, SAS, they are almost equivalent to perform EDA. Okay, you can go ahead with any of these tools without any issue. They all have got all the required packages, library and functionalities to perform the EDA, any sort of EDA with all the with all the functionalities. Next one is predictive and descriptive analysis. So here, you know, we are going to talk about some machine learning stuff, because sometimes, you know, people assume data science is nothing but making prediction. Okay, so it is not always like prediction. So basically, when you work on some machine learning model, sometimes you work on inference, sometimes you work on prediction. So there is a difference. There is a thin difference between prediction and inference. Sometimes you are just supposed to answer certain question about the data. You are supposed to answer certain question raised by business about their processes. So it can be an inference situation as well. But sometimes, yes, you actually make the predictions about the data. It can be the prediction about the future value, like time series analysis, or it can be just, you know, predicting something which is not easily available, predicting something, you know, based on some other information which is easily available. Okay, so it can be predictive as well as descriptive analysis. Sometimes you perform the descriptive analysis by taking the problem, by exploring the data, you know, from the problem point of view, then providing some, you know, detailed explanation about the problem and about the solution. Here you don't perform any sort of prediction, but you, you know, explore the problem, you describe the problem, you describe the solution. Okay, so again, any statistical tool like Python, R, SAS, they are, you know, equally good in this type of stuff, and you can go ahead with any of these. Next, relevant or, you know, equivalent, I would say very much similar type of stuff is using some statistics, statistical and probability related concepts in order to support this predictive or descriptive analysis. Okay, so basically, as a data scientist, you are supposed to work on some concepts, some advanced, some intermediate concepts from statistics and probability. You need some functions, you need some tools which can provide you the access to the functions, to the you know, techniques, theories and algorithms from statistics and probability. And that is where we exactly need some statistical tool. So R was the, you know, in the beginning, R used to be, and SAS, you can say SAS as well, they were the major player when it comes about the statistical analysis, because they have got all the library, all the functions which are used to perform any sort of statistical analysis. But over the period of time, Python has built its community. Python has got all the packages and libraries to support all this type of statistical analysis, all the functions and packages from stats and probabilities related concept. And nowadays, in fact, you know, Python is leading when it comes about the latest algorithm, latest, you know, things which are happening in the world of stats and probability. Python is, you know, growing very fastly. But yes, any of these languages, Python, R, SAS, can be utilized for all sort of statistical and probability related analysis. But definitely SAS is a paired tool. So Python and R nowadays are catching attention, and especially Python is growing faster. Next comes the analytics and visualization, and I've got many questions like how the visualization is related to data science, or where the visualization exactly takes place in a data science project. So basically, when you perform the descriptive analysis, even sometime in case of predictive analytics, you are supposed to represent the findings in the form of visual representation, in the form of interactive charts and plots, and their visualization or advanced analytics, you know, takes place in data science. Okay, so I can give you a very quick example from, for example, clustering approach. So clustering is all about dividing or, you know, segregating the data into different clusters. Okay, or it is also known as, that's why, segmentation. So when it comes about the clustering or segmentation, generally it is preferred to create an application or visual which can visually show the user how the particular data is belonging to a particular group or segment or a cluster. Okay, so this type of visual analysis is high highly important when it comes about the cluster analysis. You cannot simply make the prediction, okay, this data point will belong to cluster A or cluster B. No, you will have to show some visuals, like why this particular data is belonging to this cluster or that cluster. So a visual representation is highly required in many of the machine learning or data science related analysis. Okay, so that is why visual analysis is highly important. Many a times you are supposed to support your findings, your descriptive analysis, your conclusion with the help of charts and plots and visualization. So when it comes about visualization, then I would say Python is leading, because Python has got some very good libraries, some very good APIs to build visual analysis and application. Specifically, we talk about like Seaborn, Plotly. Plotly has got great interaction with Python, and with the help of Plotly, you can plot a variety of interactive and advanced visualization quite easily. And also Plotly provides you online way to actually productionize your visual analysis in the form of application. So Plotly is great tool which is available in Python. Apart from that, R has got RShiny. So RShiny is also used for the productionization purpose, and it is a very good tool when you want to productionize your visual or analytics related application. Okay, so RShiny is also another option. MATLAB, definitely, MATLAB is something, it used to be the leader of visual analytics and interactive visualization and advanced visualization, but now with the emergence of the open source technologies, it is not that frequently used. So Python is definitely growing every day in the fields of analytics and visualization as well. It has become a leader, no doubt. Apart from that, we have got some professional visualization tool as well. So for example, Tableau is there, ClickView is there. Okay, so these are also some visualization tool which are available in the market and which are used for specifically for this type of visualization and analytics, advanced analytics purpose. But the only problem with this type of visualization tool is they are not that much flexible. Okay, with the help of Python visualization packages, R visualization packages, you can perform a variety of customization. You can do anything that you want with your plot, with your visualization. So that is the limitation. Like these visualization tool, firstly, provide you limited options for the visualization. Secondly, it is not that much customizable as compared to a statistical tool like Python and R. Finally comes the most important and the core part of data science, which is machine learning. Okay, now in a very simple one-line definition, machine learning is nothing but applying the standard algorithm, which are already available, standard predefined algorithms which are already available. You don't define your new algorithm when you work on a data science project. Okay, so generally, in a normal scenario, you won't come up with your own algorithm. So we will use already available algorithm. We will use already available, techniques from mathematics, from statistics, from probability. We will apply those techniques, those algorithms at the top of our data. And then we customize the property of the algorithm according to our data so that we can make the correct, we can make the better prediction. And that is nothing but machine learning. Okay, so machine learning is something is what when you use the existing algorithm, already available standard algorithms at the top of your data, and you basically create a model. When you combine an algorithm with data, it becomes a machine learning model. We call it a machine learning model. Okay, so that is nothing but machine learning, applying this technique with the help of some statistical programming language, because traditional programming languages don't have this type of library to implement this type of machine learning algorithms. So that is why we need some statistical programming languages like Python, R, SAS, okay? And the comparison wise, definitely Python is leading way ahead as compared to any other statistical programming language, because Python's library are getting updated at exponential rate. All the latest research which is taking place nowadays, all the Python, everything is happening in Python. All the even the big product companies, you know, they are building their product compatible with Python. All the big data service providers, they are releasing the APIs which are compatible with Python. So whenever a new thing comes in market, okay, that is going to have the integrity already set up with Python. Later, you know, R or SAS, they will, you know, utilize this new concept either via Python or by, you know, coming by introducing a new API or custom API. But Python is the first choice for all the latest research and all the latest thing which are taking place in the market. So again, Python is a leader there. Apart from that, you know, some big organizations, some big analytics companies like Microsoft, IBM, SAP, they have released their own integrated development environment very specifically designed for machine learning and data science related analysis. So for example, Microsoft has got Azure Machine Learning Studio, then SAP has got predictive analytics. So these IDs are already there, but they are not in that much trend, okay, because they are quite simple to use. You know, you can simply drag and drop the models, you can define the flow and everything, but ultimately you are supposed to implement the logic in the form of raw language like Python and R only. Otherwise, you know, this type of high level parameter tuning can be done in just 2 lines of code or 3 lines of code, right? But when you really want to customize the algorithm, when you really want to build a specific machine learning model, you will have to do a little work with the help of coding in Python and R. So that is, if you are doing, then, you know, there is not as such need of using any ID. And also because these IDs are paired and the language statistical tool like Python, R, they are open source. So you don't need to pay for some IDs when you already have the better solution available. But yes, you know, these IDs are also catching attention nowadays. If you have the working knowledge of Python or R maybe, then, you know, you can work on any of these IDs without any problem. They are quite easy to understand, okay? So having said that, apart from, you know, all these technical stuff based on the different phases of machine data science or machine learning project, you would require some business or domain expertise, okay? But business and domain knowledge is something that you earn, okay? You cannot simply learn by going through the books or by some course or something. So that is something you learn over the period of time when you work on different domain, when you work on different businesses, then you learn, then you earn this knowledge, okay? So basically, we are not going to talk about that in detail, but yes, that is also one of the major aspect. And as a data scientist, you are supposed to have a very good functional knowledge or a domain knowledge as well. Okay, then let me see, we have some questions from in this particular context from the audience, and I've got some, what is the difference between Python or which one? So I think this question is already answered. I have covered all the explanation, all the comparison between Python and R for each and every phase. And can languages like C, Java be used instead of Python in somewhat means? Yes, so C has got this type of library for machine learning. Okay, but it is not that much user-friendly. That is why we should not, or it is not being used. Okay, if machine learning in computer vision, which language is preferred, MATLAB or Python? What are the limitations of MATLAB? So yes, MATLAB is in culture. MATLAB is being used for the visualization and analytics purpose. so far, but like Python has got its own package or library compared to MATLAB. It is matplotlib, and it provides you all the functionalities, even some better functionalities to plot and draw all type of advanced and interactive visualization. Then why would you go ahead with some paid version? Okay, so that is why I would say Python is a better option. And yeah, so someone is saying about again MATLAB, so I think we have already covered about it. With Python, do we also need a separate tool for visualization? Yes, we are having some separate tools of visualization. Special packages and libraries are available in Python, and we are going to talk about that in upcoming slide. Okay, and one important question is, what is the difference between forecast and prediction then? So yeah, forecast and prediction. So basically forecast is about, making some prediction about future. Forecasting is about time series analysis. Okay. So for example, when you make prediction about a stock price, okay. So like today's stock price is something like 110. So what will be the stock price value tomorrow for a particular stock? So when you do this type of prediction, then you use the same variable as input, or the historical value of the same variable from past, in order to make the prediction about future. That is forecasting. That is time series analysis. But in the conventional prediction, you use independent variable or separate set of independent variable or values of those variable in order to make the prediction about another variable, which is dependent variable or target variable. That is prediction. In prediction, you use only one instance of data. Okay, but in time series analysis, in forecasting, you use multiple instances of data or multiple records simultaneously to make the prediction about next value. Okay, so having said that, let me conclude this particular slide, and let us go ahead with another slide for today, and that is actually prerequisites and target audience. So I'm skipping all the questions which are related to the prerequisites and target audience. So I am getting some questions like, I have done this, I have done that, so what should I learn? Okay, so we are going to talk about prerequisites, like who is more suitable, who is the better candidate for getting into data science. Okay, so basically, if you are a professional who is already working as a data analyst, as an analytics expert, okay, your day-to-day work is to play with the data, making conclusion about the data. Basically, you are in a data analyst profile, or you are working on some visualization or analytics related tool, like you are working on Cognos, you are working on Spotfire, you are working on Tableau, ClickView. Okay, and again, if you are working from the data warehouse or BI background, like you are an ETL developer, you are an ETL architect, ETL designer, you are a data architect, you are a data warehouse architect, you are a data warehouse developer, or you are a big data engineer, big data developer, big data designer. These are some roles which are already in the field from business intelligence, right? So you are already working from business intelligence background, and business intelligence, you can simply understand it like that. Business intelligence is nothing but like just before the data science or predictive analytics. Okay, so business intelligence is step one, and followed by that we have advanced analytics or predictive analytics, okay, descriptive analytics. So there, that is why all those candidates who are working in the fields of ETL, data analysis, analytics, visualization, big data, data warehouse, they are the most suitable candidate to get into data science. Okay, so if you are already from any of these domain, any of these areas, you don't need to think at all. You are the most suitable candidate, and whatever experience that you have gained so far while working on these technologies in these areas, everything will be counted toward data science. So sometimes, you know, people have the question, what about my experience I have so far? So if you are already from, if you have worked already in these areas on these technologies, on these techniques, then this entire experience is going to be counted towards data science without any problem. Okay, apart from that, you know, it is not the thing that, you know, only these candidate, only these professionals can get into data science. But if you want, you know, I have seen many cases where people from totally different area, even some, you know, senior people who have got very little technical knowledge, they are now, you know, doing good in data science and machine learning. So basically, it is not like that. Okay, so what is the minimum criteria? What are the minimum things at minimum level I should know, and so that I can start my journey towards data science and maybe from scratch? So basically, if you have some basic understanding of any programming language, programming concepts like C, C++, Java, some RDBMS concept, maybe PLSQL knowledge, okay, so basically, if you are comfortable with programming, okay, then you can consider yourself as eligible to get into data science. Apart from programming skills, you will require some knowledge, some intermediate level knowledge of mathematics and statistics, some probability related concepts as well. I assume that as a part of statistics only. So definitely, if you will have to study a little bit mathematics and statistics, okay, because we have sometime it happens, like, you know, we have studied maths and stats during our graduation or using out during our school. So if you are not very much keen, then you will have to show little interest in study, because you will have to start studying as well. Okay, so I'm not deny this fact that you will not have to study. No, so if you really want to pursue your career in data science, you are serious about it, then definitely mathematics and statistics concepts are going to be there, okay, and you will have to learn them. Followed by that, the knowledge of reporting and visualization tool. Okay, so you will have to have little understanding of, you know, visualization and analytics. Okay, if you don't have, then you will have to learn some visualization. The better way would be just, you know, take a particular some visualization tool which is freely available. Like, you can take Tableau as well. It comes with 1 month trial period, and then you can get yourself comfortable with different type of plots and charts. Okay, so it provides you some very good tutorial as well, online available on the Tableau website itself. And then you can make yourself comfortable with different type of plot. What is tab, what is bar plot, what is histogram, pie chart, line plot, scatter plot. So, you know, we have different type of plots which are used for different purpose. Okay, but this type of basic understanding of all these visualization and plots is definitely going to be very useful. Apart from all these things, if you think like, something is missing, I know programming, but I don't know visualization, I'm good in math, but I don't know programming. So sometimes, you know, some lagging can be there. But I would say if you have determination, if you can show the dedication and consistency, if you are confident enough, then there is no hurdle. Okay, I've seen the folks who are from even commerce background, and they haven't studied math basically or stats after their high school at all, but they have learned everything with all the expertise, because that is the benefit nowadays. You know, a lot of resources are available. It is just about your confidence. It is just about your dedication. If you can show the determination, if you can put the efforts, then there is nothing you cannot learn. Okay, so basically you are going to need some self-motivation in order to go ahead, because data science is something which cannot be learned, or you cannot become a data scientist just by learning a statistical programming language like I know Python, now I am a data scientist, or I know R, now I am a data scientist. So it is not like that. It is going to be a journey. Okay, you will start this journey. You have already started this journey from today by attending this webinar, and then you are supposed to continue this journey by adding little things on a daily basis to your knowledge. Okay, just don't break this journey. Be consistent, and on a daily basis, on a regular basis, you know, learn something new, explore some new things, okay, about data science, machine learning, stats and everything. Okay, so it is going to be a long journey, but yeah, if you are really putting the efforts, then over the period of like 8 months to 1 year, you can really stand at a position to actually get into data science. Okay, maybe as a data engineer, maybe as a data analyst, or simply as a data science team member. But an effort of 6 months to 8 months, depending on your efforts, depending on your hard work, can get you into a data science job. Okay, now we are going to start with data science, project life cycle. Okay, and we are going to talk about a very famous data science project life cycle model, which is CRISP-DM model. Okay, and before I start with that, let me go through if we have some new questions from the last topics. Okay, so Pankaj is saying, I have just completed my M.Tech in Communication Engineering Electronics. I would love to make my career in AI and data science. So what should I do first? Okay, so Pankaj, I think this can be the question from many other folks who have just completed their graduation or something. I would suggest you to start learning data science and machine learning. Maybe you can join some courses. So Cognixia is providing many courses. Like we are going to launch a data science course with Python in coming week. Okay, so you can consider that as well. And Cognixia support team is there to help you with all the detail about the course, content, curriculum, everything, because it is highly recommended to follow a track of learning. So many a times it happens that we start something, but because we don't have proper guidance and we don't have proper content available with us, we get distracted. Okay, we stop the things in between. Okay, so the ideal way, or the fast way, okay, the fast track way would be to join some professional course using which you can consistently grow, you can consistently continue your journey, and you can be provided a guided approach to pursue your career in the fields of data science. Okay. Okay, then Ankush is saying deep learning versus neural network. So deep learning and neural network are equivalent to each other. Nothing but same thing. Okay, so deep learning is implemented in the form of neural network only. Okay, then Venkat is saying, what are the chances for freshers to get into data science? So, freshers are also getting jobs in the fields of data science, because data science is not something which, or data science project is not something which is fully implemented by only a data scientist or a senior data scientist or senior data analyst. Generally, all the big organization require a complete data science team, and you will see that in a complete data science team you will find a couple of senior data scientists or data analysts will be there. Apart from that, you will find 4 or 5 data engineers will be there. So based on the expertise, they would need some ETL developer, some big data developer, some data analyst, some junior data analyst, senior data scientist. Okay, so they require different people. The important thing is, nowadays freshers are also getting job in the fields of data science or machine learning. If you have some basic understanding, if you have at basic or intermediate level knowledge of data science and machine learning, and you know some data engineering related tool. For example, you are good in ETL, you are good in PL/SQL, you are a good Python developer. Okay, then as well, Python, learning Python is a very is very good opportunity for freshers, because in a data science team, definitely organizations would need some Python developer. So what happens, like senior data scientist or senior data analyst will guide the junior Python developer, and they will help, they will assist the data scientist to implement the model, to perform the coding. Okay, so that is why Python developers are directly getting job in a data science team at junior level as a Python developer, as a data engineer. Later, because as soon as you will start working as a part of data science team, you will learn the remaining things gradually at very fast rate. Okay. Okay, then I got one question, like ETL, can you elaborate ETL a little bit more in terms of professional working of ETL? So ETL is, like we have got some professional tools like Informatica, and ETL is all about, extracting the data from different sources, performing the transformation at the top of data. For example, you get raw data from the sources, you aggregate the data, you combine the data, you join the data together, and finally you load the apps. Extract data, aggregated data, or joined data in the target database. So that is all about ETL. I hope you can find very good stuff available online if you do a little bit search. So I would not go ahead with that. Okay. Okay, then what are the possibilities and opportunities in the field of data science in India as of now? What does the future of data science look like in another 5 years in terms of demand in India? And a very good question, and basically not in coming 5 years, I would say in next, already, the huge requirement is there. And if you will see the next 2 years or 3 years, in India, the market of data science and machine learning is getting attention at exponential rate. Mainly, you already know, like we have n number of private banks nowadays. That is going to be a very good example. You might not be aware that most of the very big private bank, like many brands are there in the market, they have already started working on data science, internal data science and machine learning project. They have got their in-house data science team, and they are working on different type of predictive and data science and machine learning models in order to assist, in order to make their banking operations, in order to make the organization, the bank, more profitable. Okay, so this is the thing which is currently taking place in almost all sort of industry. The good thing about data science role is that an organization and a company, a business might not need IT, complete IT infrastructure. But in near future, you will see they will start directly recruiting the data scientist or data analyst, in limited numbers. But yes, each and every organization, each and every, business, regardless of the domain, regardless of the area, they have already started recruiting data science. Okay. So the prospect is quite good. The opportunities are quite good. And yes, Indian companies as well as multinational companies are recruiting data science professionals at rapid rate. Okay, then. Okay, so I've got a very big question. Now, many open source tools are available nowadays to work with automated as compared to why learn language such as Python or R, where all we've done click based. Okay, so basically, when you actually talk about real data science or real machine learning, okay, working on IDE is not the real data science. Okay, frankly speaking, anyone who has got little expertise on data science or machine learning concept can do the click and do the drag and drop and build the model. But that is not the expectation, that is not the reality. When you actually work on a actual data science or machine learning project in business, you will realize how complex or how tedious job it is to work on the real data. When you work on real data, you have to you have to perform a lot of transformation, a lot of engineering stuff on the real data, on the raw data, in order to make it compatible, in order to make it in the form so that you can further deliver it in the form of machine learning model. This type of data engineering or this type of data cleansing, data massaging, or data engineering stuff cannot be performed automatically by any IDE. It cannot be performed at all, and that is where a good data engineer, a good data analyst or data scientist is required, who can actually understand the lags, who can actually understand the problem with the data and address that problem with the required transformation. Okay, that is where all these, that is the area where all these inbuilt, ready-made framework or IDs are lagging. All the big companies have come up with this type of solution, with this type of ID, as I mentioned earlier, but they are not that much in use. Okay, still all the organization and businesses are using the statistical programming languages like Python. Okay, and Mahesh is asking if machine learning is useful in networking domain. Yes, Mahesh, it is quite useful, and in networking as well. Many things related to signal logs and access security. You will find many machine learning use cases have already been have already implemented by many big organizations. So if you want, you can explore a little. And there is no domain, where machine learning or data science is not being used at all. Okay, I have certain depth of knowledge in Python. So now do I have to learn other, like Tableau also? Is it necessary to keep learning different tool for data analysis? No, I would say if you already know Python, then you don't need to learn any other statistical tool at least. But make sure like you are good in all the aspect of it. Okay, so you should be good with data engineering using Python. Okay, when it comes about data engineering, data transformation, you should be able to work with NumPy, with pandas. You should be comfortable with performing all sort of data aggregation, slicing, dicing, filtering, computation, matrix computation. You should also be good with the visualization package of Python, for example, matplotlib, plotly, seaborn. Then you should be good in the machine learning packages of Python. So for example, scikit-learn, you should know some deep learning libraries. So in that way, you can proceed further rather than learning any good new tool or technology. Okay. Someone asking, what are the difference between data science and machine learning? So see, data science is, you can say, an umbrella. Within that umbrella, we have machine learning as well. Sometimes a data science project can be a pure inferential project, descriptive analysis project, where you are supposed to work on some straightforward things like hypothesis testing, some inferential analysis related thing, where you are supposed to answer certain business questions, when you are supposed to solve certain business problem, and you would not require a particular prediction related thing or machine learning model as such. You will utilize some concepts of statistics, maths, analysis, data analysis, visualization, and that's it. Okay, so that's why data science is a big thing, is a big umbrella, and within that umbrella, machine learning is a big area, is a big, you can say, subdomain within data science. Okay. And so if the data has more outlier, then if the data science is good. So basically, I've got some specific question. So about the outlier analysis. So see, it is not like that. If you have the outlier in your data, then you cannot perform data analysis or machine learning. There are many ways to fix the outlier, to address this type of missing data or outlier data. So with the help of outlier analysis, you can actually remove the outlier. You can replace the outlier value with some more suitable, or you can say, relevant information, and then you can further proceed with your analysis, with your machine learning model building. So outlier analysis or outlier treatment is a part of data pre-processing phase of data science project. Okay, so I think we can further proceed with the new topics. Okay, And next, we are going to talk about, as I was mentioning earlier, data science project lifecycle, and I was talking about CRISP model. Okay, so what is CRISP basically? So CRISP is a very famous model, and basically this particular model was designed, was brought into picture for data mining stuff in late 90s. Okay, so basically data mining is nothing but you can say the emergence of data science. So in 90s, you know, when big organizations, when big companies, they were facing this situation, when they were facing this problem of huge data, they were looking for some sort of solution to analyze that data, to mine that data in order to retrieve some important information out of data. At that time, at that point in time, there were no standard model available. Every organization was doing that data mining, their data mining operations differently. So at that point in time, you know, a committee was formed, and that committee has come up with a very standard model. This is also known, the full form of the CRISP model is cross industry standard process for data mining. Okay, so basically a model, a framework, a standard has been designed which can be utilized by all the industries regardless of their domain, regardless of their type, and using this model they can perform a data mining project in a step-by-step standard manner. So this CRISP DM model talks about all the phases, activities, and tasks which are performed in a traditional complete data science project. Okay, so let us go through this CRISP DM model and let us talk about all the different phases, activities, and tasks it suggests for a data science project. So the first phase, as you can see in this data science project lifecycle, is the business understanding phase. And business understanding phase is the initial step to start a data science or machine learning project. So basically in this particular phase, as a data scientist, as a data analyst, you interact with the user, you interact with the business analyst, with the end user, with the client, you gather the business specific knowledge, you make yourself comfortable with the business requirement, and ultimately you try to understand the project objective from business point of view. So for example, what business is looking for, or what is the pain area of the business, what is the pain area of your customer, what type of specific solution your client, your business is looking for. Then from that problem point of view, you start building your business knowledge or domain knowledge. Followed by that comes the data understanding phase, and data understanding phase is nothing but when you start analyzing the data. So after performing the business understanding phase, you start with the data understanding phase. You collect the data, you start analyzing the data from the business understanding, from the business problem point of view. So now you already know what business is looking for. In data understanding phase, you start stitching back the data with the business. Okay, if the data is available to solve this problem or not. If data is available, then which specific data do I need in order to answer this business problem? Okay, so you start understanding the data, you perform the exploratory data analysis, you perform the descriptive analysis, statistical analysis, all sort of analysis you perform in order to understand the data. Followed by that, you work on data preparation phase. Data preparation phase is also known as data engineering or data pre-processing phase. And this is the phase where we need the data engineer, the junior data scientist, or entry-level data science professional. In this particular phase, we need Python developer, R developer, big data developer, ETL developer, visualization developers as well. So in this particular phase, a senior data scientist or data scientist will guide the team of data engineer in order to perform the data engineering or data transformation related stuff. How the data is supposed to be transformed, how the data is supposed to be aggregated, how the data is supposed to be managed, and finally make it available in the format which can be utilized by the next step of CRISP DM model, which is modeling. Okay, so here comes the modeling phase after the data preparation phase. And modeling phase is nothing, once your data is available in the form, then in the required form, then you apply some standard algorithm, then you apply the standard in already available algorithm at the top of your data. And once you combine the data with algorithm, it becomes a model. Definitely you perform some customization, okay, with the help of a statistical tool like Python. So you import a library, and then you import its function to implement a particular type of algorithm. You implement that algorithm at the top of data, and then you make some settings. That setting is nothing but like parameter setting or parameter tuning. You set the parameter of the algorithm at the optimum level, so that your algorithm can be in sync with your data. Your algorithm will give you the best possible result. Okay, so that is all about the modeling phase, combining the algorithm, standard algorithm at the top of your data with the data, integrating the algorithm with the data, and the output is going to be a machine learning model. Then comes the evaluation, a very critical and a very crucial phase of data science or machine learning project lifecycle. Evaluation is also known as like cross-validation. You perform the model cross-validation, you evaluate your model. So basically, when you are supposed to work on a particular problem, maybe it's a classification problem, it can be a clustering problem, it can be a time series problem, it can be association problem. So you can have different type of problems, machine learning problem or data science problem. But the thing is, you can have multiple options. If you are working on a classification problem, you can work on decision tree, you can work on random forest, you can work on k nearest neighbor, you can work on support vector machine, you can work on naive Bayes classifier. So basically we have different classifier, for example, available. Now, which particular classifier is going to be more suitable in our situation? Okay, which particular model is giving what type of accuracy, what type of precision? So all this type of things you do in your data in your model evaluation or cross validation phase after building the model. Sometimes you build more than one model, just because of because we have multiple options available, we explore which particular model should be the better model. If you think like we have more than one models, we have more than one algorithm which can be suitable for this problem, then no problem, go ahead and build multiple models. And finally, in the evaluation phase, you can perform a comparative analysis of these models, which one can be the best possible model for my problem. Okay, for my data. So this type of model evaluation, comparative evaluation, or independent evaluation is performed in evaluation phase with the help of different type of model evaluation techniques. Finally comes the final phase of CRISP DM process model, which is deployment. Or deployment is also known as like productionization. So basically, when you work on traditional machine learning model, other than inferences, other than descriptive analysis, other than a statistical analysis, so these are those things which are not supposed to be deployed as such in production in the form of model. Okay, so it is not the 100% case, like it is not always be the case you will always deploy your model in production. No, sometimes you simply finish the project, sometimes you simply finish your machine learning or data science project by providing certain answers, by providing certain description, certain explanation behind the problem or behind the data. Okay, so that is also something which is expected sometime from data science scientist or from data science team. But sometimes on the other side, you are supposed to actually productionize the model at the top of the decision making system of your organization. Okay, so basically decision making system is nothing but the system through which the data is flowing. You are getting new data from the sources, right? So based on that data, using that data, you will productionize the model, and that data will be integrated with the productionized data model, and the model will make the prediction about the newly coming data from the decision making system of the organization. Now the question arises, how exactly do we perform the model deployment or model productionization. So basically, there are multiple ways to productionize your model. Sometimes very simply, your Python script, your R script is scheduled with the help of some scripting or scheduling tool, like with the help of ETL tool as well. You can schedule the script as a cron job. So at a particular time, your script will be executed. It will pick up the data file from certain location, from certain table, and the model is already built. You will initially build the model and you will export the model. Your script will pick up the model from the exported version, and then it will use the latest data to make the prediction, and then the results are stored in the form of file and table. So this is also one of the traditional way to productionize the model in production. Apart from that, we have got some better options nowadays to perform the productionization, and those options are productionizing your model in the form of applications, web applications. So for example, we have got Django, we have got RShiny. So RShiny can be integrated with Python as well. So it is not the thing like you can use RShiny only to productionize the R models, but yes, you can also productionize the Python models with the help of RShiny. Then you have got the Django. You can also, you know, create the APIs, and in turn the APIs can make a call to the Python script, and accordingly your model can be triggered, and you know, again the same thing can be repeated. So based on your environment, based on your decision making system, your ETL system, your database system, your environment, you can pick up any of these methods. And web applications are definitely a better option, because you can very easily share those web applications across your organization with all the end users, and they can simply log into the web application and they can perform their analysis, they can perform the prediction with the help of these web applications effectively, efficiently. Okay, so this was all about the, you know, data science project life cycle according to CRISP, cross-industry process for data mining. And this was all about all the phases, like how a data traditional data science project is executed in phase-wise manner. Okay. And now let me see if we have got some questions in this particular area. Okay. So I'm, you know, skipping some questions that we have already discussed. I hope you have got the question answers already, or the questions that we have already discussed. Based on the CRISP model, what data scientists work on, when data scientists work on a new problem, on what basis do they evaluate their new model? Meaning there won't be reference for comparison because this is an absolutely new problem. A good question. So basically, you know, there are certain model evaluation techniques available. For example, we have model cross-validation techniques. We have like K-fold cross-validation, leave one out cross-validation. We have for categorical dependent variable, we have some cross-validation techniques like performing the ROC curve analysis, like true positive rate, false positive rate. Then we have like confusion matrix basically. And for regression evaluation, regression related algorithms, we have regression evaluation matrices, like we have RMSE value, MSE value. Okay, so this type of, you know, different evaluation techniques we have. So you don't need to always perform the baseline analysis, but using these model evaluation techniques, you perform how good or bad your model is. Okay. Okay, then how many models can be made in a single project? Also, do models have any classification or levels based on their complexity, or the algorithm of every model is same? So basically, you know, it there is no limit to solve one particular problem. You can use multiple model, but generally to solve one part of the problem. Like to solve one particular objective, you will always use just one model. It should not happen like just for one objective, you are building more than one model. Okay. So you will build only one model for one particular type of problem. And then your second question is like, do model have any classification? So yeah, actually, you know, for different type of problem, we have different type of models. For example, when your target variable is continuous in nature, you will work on some regression related problem, regression related models like linear regression, polynomial regression. Okay, then you can also work on decision tree or random forest, like decision tree, regression decision tree, basically. When your target variable is categorical in nature, so mainly you will work on some classification type of problem. So you can have n number of algorithm for classification. So basically, yes, there is a classification of the algorithm. So we have some regression algorithm, we have some classification algorithm, we have time series algorithm, we have clustering algorithm, we have association analysis algorithm. So yes, there is a classification available. Okay, then is it a good statement that there is a time series data and for single instance, a single data model is used for prediction? Is it good approach? It is not only for time series. I would say it is good approach to have a single model for single objective at a time. But yes, I'm not denying the fact you should consider all the possible item. But yes, you should go ahead only with one model after performing the comparative analysis. Okay. Example, in oil and gas, there are 10 wells. So by taking the relevant parameter of data model is prepared. But for one well, there is one data model. So is it good approach or not? As each well has different behavior, it can be good approach. Okay, if really they are showing heterogeneous behavior, then Dolly, yeah, it can be a good approach to have a different model for each segment, for example, specifically in your oil and gas case. Okay, but I don't really think there will be that much heterogeneous in nature, and in many cases, you know, one model can do a better job. Okay, so try to come up with the best possible model. Okay, it should not be the case. You just want to try the variety. That is why we are using n number of different model. Okay, so that should not be the case for sure. Okay, then is there any other model than CRISP? CRISP is very very relevant and very standard model. And as such, you know, I would say not any other model, but you know, you can customize this according to your requirement. So according to the business requirement and business problem, it might be possible. You will customize it. You will use some limited activities and tasks rather than performing all the phases. You can make it more agile according to your requirement. Rather than including all the objectives at a time, you can go ahead in agile manner. So this type of customization is possible, but this is a very standard approach. Okay, then brief the classification, inference, clustering algorithm example, regression. So I have already talked about classification and regression. Like in case of classification, Dolly, you know, your target variable is going to be categorical in nature. You want to predict the class. You want to make the prediction about the category generally. Okay, so that is classification. In regression type of approach, your target variable is going to be continuous in nature. You can take the example of like prediction the sales, prediction the revenue, anything which is continuous in nature, numeric in nature. So that will be the example of all the regression related you know, techniques. In clustering, you know, you simply divide the data, you divide the data points into multiple clusters or segments based on the similarity and dissimilarity. So your objective is to, you know, segregate the data. It is a type of unsupervised machine learning approach. Okay, then in association analysis, you simply see the association between the events which are taking place simultaneously. If there is a pattern available like event A and event B, most of the time it is possible like some events like A and B will take place simultaneously most of the time. So this is a type of association analysis. You can use association analysis in shopping in you know, shopping mall type of scenarios, or like consumer market. So for example, all the products which are generally bought together by the customer. So this type of problem using the shopping cart analysis can be solved with the help of association analysis. Generally, when you perform the online shopping, you must be seeing this type of message, like after, you know, putting your order, they show you a message. Generally, people buy this type of two things together. Are you interested in this another product B? So all this, you know, is taking place. All this is happening based on some association and analysis algorithm. Okay, then I got one question. Is it having production testing and development environment? For sure, actually. So basically, you know, we in data science as well, we follow traditional approach. Firstly, we build the model in development environment or testing environment. Generally, we work, two environments are sufficient, not test development, testing, and production environment. And one reason can be the data as well. But to build your model, even in development environment, you will use the production data only. That is the big difference as compared to any traditional IT software development project. In data science, you need always real data. So maybe you are working in development environment, you will use the production data. Okay. Okay, then I got, please state the examples of regression algorithm. So Dolly, because of the limited time and standard content, I would not be able to cover everything in detail. So I hope you will understand. Otherwise, you know, we will miss some important topics that we are supposed to cover in today's session. Okay. Okay, so now we are moving ahead and we are going to start with the next topic for today, which is Python for data science. Why Python is actually, you know, a distinct statistical programming language as compared to other available programming languages like R, SAS, okay? So we have many options, then why only Python? Okay, why Python is so much special? So firstly, we will try to understand some expectations from a perfect statistical programming language, and then you will understand how Python, you know, is actually so special, what different different options or what different features it provides against all these expectations. Okay, so let us go through all the expectation from a latest statistical programming language nowadays, because the traditions are changing in data science and machine learning at rapid level. So in the latest world, what are the expectations from a good statistical programming language? Okay. So first of all, when you work on a data science or machine learning project, firstly, you deal with data, right? Your first entity is data. So you will have to deal with all sort of data, structured data, unstructured data, semi-structured data, data present in a database system, data present in file, flat file, big data. So data can be anywhere or data can be present in any format. You need some statistical programming language which can read the data from all type of system and which can read all type of data, and also it can perform all sort of data management activities. It provides you all data management functionalities. Okay, so that is the very big expectation from any statistical programming language: the compatibility with all sort of data and the connection with all different type of sources of data. Second thing is especially designed data structure for numeric computation. So not only the integration. Okay, so for example, you can connect any language with most of the data sources. So you can read data from different sources in many programming languages. But apart from that, you need some specialized data structures. You need some composite data structure which can store the data in the format which are available. Okay, so you need some specific data, specially designed data structure, which are not available in most of the traditional languages. And basically, we are talking about one-dimensional data structure, like array-like structure, two-dimensional data structure, like matrices, then a real-world two-dimensional data structure, like a relational database table, which we call data frame. Okay, so this type of data structure should be available in a statistical programming language to perform the numeric computations. Then we need machine learning libraries. So all the standard machine learning algorithms, all the standard approaches, all the standard frameworks which are available to implement machine learning and deep learning. So that libraries, those packages should be available. Advanced data exploration and visual analytics. So yes, as a part of exploratory data analysis, as a part of interactive analysis, data analysis, when performing data analysis, you are supposed to perform, different type of data exploration. And when it comes to data exploration, your statistical programming language should be able to provide you, all the ways to perform all sort of interactive and visual analysis, advanced visualization. So your statistical programming language should have got all the visualization and analytics libraries and packages. APIs to support big data integration. So your statistical programming language should be compatible with all the big data platform, because that is the biggest challenge with many statistical tool. Okay, so Python is definitely leading there, and we'll talk about that. But yes, because nowadays we are working on big data platform mainly, so your statistical programming language should be compatible with big data. It should be integrated with big data platform to read data, to write data. Okay. Advanced deep learning packages. So yes, after machine learning, we have deep learning. So some programming languages like R, okay, R has got limited packages or limited integration or limited functionalities or libraries available for deep learning. It in turn depend on Python. For example, when you implement Keras, okay, for deep learning. So Python has got definitely major advantage there. All the latest thing which is taking place in the field of deep learning, reinforcement learning, neural network, everything is being developed accordingly in Python. Okay, so APIs are being developed in Python so that you can implement all sort of deep learning concepts. So you can build deep learning models in Python. Easy application development and deployment. So finally, when you are done with all sort of phases of data science or machine learning, basically when your model is ready, your final product is ready, you are supposed to deploy that analysis, you are supposed to deploy that model to production. So your statistical programming language should provide you efficient and effective way to deploy your model in the form of application, in the form of product, right? So there should be application development and deployment possible. Okay, now let us go through some of the important aspects we just discussed from Python point of view, like how Python is providing solution to all these expectation, to all these problems. Okay, firstly, data extraction and data management. So basically, Python has got some very specialized data structure to deal with this type of structured and composite data structures. NumPy is there to perform all sort of numerical computations on unidimensional array. Okay, one-dimensional array type of data structure or vector type of data structure, where you need to perform the computation on single dimensional array or vector type of data structure. So Python has got NumPy to perform the numeric computations on array. Next, we got Pandas. Pandas is the package or is the library which supports the real world two-dimensional data structure that we call data frame. So basically in real world, in RDB, for example, in any sort of RDBMS system like Oracle, SQL Server, how do we store the data? We store the data in the form of row and column. So that structure we need, which is missing in many traditional languages like in Java, C, we cannot have a single data structure to represent a table, right? So far in all the programming languages, we don't have that structure available. That structure is only available in relational database systems. But now, yes, in a statistical programming language, we have data frames, and data frames are nothing but equivalent to the two-dimensional tables or simply the Excel file where you can have the data stored in the form of row and column, and each column can have its own data type. Okay, then nowadays we are not only dealing with the structured data, but we also have data coming in the form of XML file, HTML file. So we need a statistical language which can, you know, extract the data, manage the data, present in XML, HTML file as well, apart from the database, apart from the CSV files, Excel files. We need some solution to extract the data from XML and HTML. Okay, now Python has got a very good package, BeautifulSoup. With the help of BeautifulSoup, it has become a lot easy to extract this type, extract any sort of information present in the form of XML or HTML. You can extract the data from the websites. Okay, you can read the data present in HTML format. Okay, so that is also an added advantage which is available in Python, which is missing in other statistical tool, or it is not that much easy in other statistical tool. So BeautifulSoup is a great answer to that. Next comes the machine learning libraries. So definitely when you work on machine learning data science project, you are supposed to implement the model with the help of some algorithm, right? Using some algorithm, you will build the model. So you need some libraries, you need some packages which provides you this flexibility to choose any sort of algorithm. It should not happen that you have limited options, or for one sort of algorithm you need one library, for another algorithm you need another library. So in R it happens like, you know, when you work on one model you need one library, for another model, another algorithm, you need another library. Okay, but in Python actually you have got for example scikit-learn, a complete package for all sort of machine learning algorithms. You don't need to go anywhere and you don't need to install any other package if you are good in scikit-learn. Scikit-learn not only provides you comprehensive options to implement any sort of algorithm, but it also provides you all sort of, you know, model validation, model evaluation, cross validation, training test, data split, all sort of activity, you know, that you perform during the data pre-processing, data engineering. Okay, so all this type of supporting functions are also available in scikit-learn. So a very good library, a very good package which makes all the things at one place for you, all the algorithms available at one place for you. Then comes the advanced data exploration and visual analytics. Okay, so as I mentioned, visual analytics, interactive analytics is definitely a very important aspect of data science analysis. And that is why, you know, MATLAB was the leader, you know, in performing the statistical analysis, advanced analysis. But with the emergence of the open source technologies like R and Python, now you can perform the advanced visualization, interactive visualization with all the professional look and feel with the help of Python itself. So just like in R, we have a ggplot2, very famous package, which is used for the visualization purpose. Very similarly in Python, we have multiple options. So not just one option, matplotlib, which is like the answer to MATLAB. Okay, so when all the plots, all the charts, all the visualization that you can do in MATLAB, everything is possible in matplotlib, which is a package of Python using which you can draw, you can build all sort of advanced and interactive visualization. Apart from that, in Python we have plotly is a great way to productionize, to not only to develop your visual and interactive analysis, but also you can productionize your analysis, your visual analysis in the form of web application. So plotly is the counterpart, or plotly is the answer to the R Shiny from R. So all the things that you can do with the help of R Shiny in R, that you can do here with the help of plotly in Python. Apart from that, we have got another package of Python, which is Seaborn. Seaborn is the very effective and very efficient way to perform all sort of visual and analytics, statistical analysis related plottings. So when you are supposed to perform distribution analysis, probability related analysis, hypothesis testing, so some special, pop plots and charts are required. Seaborn is the perfect answer to all this type of visual aspects, and it provides you very easy way to draw this type of complex plots and charts. Okay, so Python is has got more than required plotting packages and libraries. So one type of plot can be built, can be drawn with the help of Python in multiple ways. So the same plot that you can draw in Matplotlib, the same plot you can draw in Plotly as well, in Seaborn as well. So not one way. Python is providing you n number of ways for data visualization and exploratory data analysis. And then comes the deep learning packages. So there is no question, there is no confusion at all that all the latest work, all the latest things which are taking place in the fields of deep learning, in the fields of advanced machine learning, all those things are being developed considering Python as the major platform of application. Okay, so for example, the biggest example of are Keras, TensorFlow, OpenCV. All these are the platform, all these are the APIs which have been specially designed, so that it can provide you the compatibility, the integration with Python. In fact, you can use Keras to implement deep learning, to implement neural network in R as well, but you will have to rely on Python. Okay, so basically in turn, Keras will call the Python utilities in R, but in R according to R syntax. Okay, so definitely Python is leader here, and Keras is nothing but you can understand it as a wrapper to the TensorFlow. So TensorFlow is the deep learning library. It is the most famous. It is the highly used deep learning library nowadays, and Keras provide you a wrapper to that TensorFlow library. So with the help of Keras, you can implement all the complex, high level functionalities of TensorFlow very easily by writing some simple code. Okay, so that you will get the same functionality, you will get the same result, but at the minimum work. Okay, so Keras is there to support you in Python to implement any sort of deep learning or neural network related project or requirement. Then we have got OpenCV. OpenCV is all about visual processing of your data, present in the form of pictures, present in the form of videos. So nowadays, we see all this type of stuff like where we use face recognition, we use photo recognition. So this type of things can be implemented with the help of OpenCV very well, and OpenCV is a platform which you can use in Python without any issue. Basically, it has been designed so that it can be integrated with Python, and you can use it for this type of facial recognition or image processing things very easily with the help of Python. So in short, Python provides you all sort of latest and advanced technologies in order to implement any sort of deep learning or neural network related machine learning model or deep learning model. And it has got all the things, all the latest things which are taking place currently in market. So firstly, all the APIs, everything is implemented in Python, and then you will find that these things are now available in other statistical programming languages as well. Okay, finally comes the deployment and productionization of the application or machine learning models. So as I mentioned earlier, now we have got some very advanced methods to productionize or to deploy the machine learning model or deep learning model in the form of application. And the answer is like Django and Flask. So with the help of these Django and Flask, especially designed frameworks using which you can create your application, you can convert your machine learning or deep learning model in the form of application, web application, and then you can deploy those application on server. So like a user or an end user, even if he or she is not having any knowledge, any exposure to data science, they can also use these models just like an application, just like a web page or a web application. They can simply hit the URL, open the application, and perform the analysis and perform the prediction and everything. They don't need to install Python. They don't need to install like Anaconda, Spider, any IDE, basically any, you know, programming language on their machine. They can use the application on their mobile, on their pad, on their laptop, from wherever they want to see it. Okay, so this type of flexibility Python is providing you with the help of Django and Flask. Okay, so definitely Python is leader here. And having said that, we are right at time to conclude this session here. And now I will go through all the remaining questions. And this is the time, if you think you have something to ask that you haven't asked already, please feel free to ask your questions. Okay, let me go through all the questions that we have already got so far. Okay, so what is meant by advanced analytics, difference with data analytics, how deep learning packages are different from machine learning packages? So the your second question, Dolly, is too much generic, and sorry, I would not be able to answer this type of question in a short one or two line. So let me try to answer your first question. What is the difference between advanced analytics and data analytics? So data analytics is nothing but business intelligence, regular data analytics, like you represent the information in the form of visual analytics, and mainly in the traditional analytics, you try to represent what is happening. Okay, you try to represent in next level, you try to represent why it is happening. Okay, and in advanced analytics, you also represent what can happen in future. So that is the biggest difference between the traditional BI approach or traditional analytics approach and advanced analytics approach. Also, another aspect in advanced analytics approach, nowadays we can build interactive visualization where you cannot simply show the graph and plots, but you can also play with it. You can at runtime, after building the plot or analytics, you can interact with that plot. You can see a particular portion of the plot. You can stretch it. You can zoom it, zoom out. You can, you know, further expand it at particular portion. It can give you different information or different type of information by taking different action. Okay, so this type of interactive plotting is performed with the help of advanced analytics. Okay, if we need to understand which libraries helps to this data engineering, data analytics in Python, how can we get that info, which are the correct suitable library? So Revanth, this is not something I can answer in one line, but yeah, I think I have explained it already. Like you can use for data management, data extraction, NumPy, pandas for visualization, for application development, right? So I think now you should be good. We have already covered this particular thing in brief. And according to you, for dealing with 100 plus variable and 10,000 plus observation, which program is best for regression, SAS or Python? Okay, so basically it depends on your infrastructure as well, but I don't think so there is going to be any challenge for 100 plus variable or 10,000 plus observation in any statistical programming language. Okay, so for this particular data set, Hardik, even if you go with R, Python, SAS, these all are going to process your data without any problem. In Keras, through Python programming, we can do this thing, I assume you want to say, OpenCV, Python programming, or some other coding language is used in it. Sorry, Dolly, I'm not able to understand your question completely. If the developer working on production data, then there is possibility to view sensitive data, right? Like no person income. Yes, it is the challenge, Sham. And this is the challenge, you know, generally you will face while working on a data science project. Information is sensitive. And that is why sometime during the development or initial phase, limited information is provided. Sometime historical information is also provided in order to avoid the information breach. And also sometimes, you know, information is provided or shared with limited resources, like only to the senior data scientist, data analyst, and followed by that, you know, this information is passed through the remaining team. Okay, but yeah, that is a valid question, but that is a valid challenge. Okay, can OpenCV only used with Python? OpenCV is can be used with other programming languages as well, but Python, it has got the best integration with Python. You can use it very easily with Python. Okay, the best option is Python. Application development for R data models, can Django be used in it? So generally, Dolly, R Shiny is used for application development for R because it has got great compatibility with R. Okay, Himanshu, you are looking for some university. Sorry, this question is out of scope, so I would not be able to answer it. What should be the salary of fresher in the field of data scientist? Abhishek Mittal is asking. Abhishek, so at the entry level, and specifically, I assume your question is about Indian market, then I would say at the entry level for fresher, you can get the offer somewhere in the range from 4.5 LPA to 8 LPA at the entry level. How does the class work? I think you can, for that question, Kehinde, you can get in touch with Cognixia support team. They can help you with all the all the help. They can help you with all the questions, all the queries related to the course and class and everything. How many type of data format it will support? Data format, I assume you are asking Galaxy on next, how many type of data form, data structure, or data format Python supports. So Python has got its all the scalar data types, like string, numeric, integer, double. So this type of data frames are already there, but for the computational purpose, it has got list, dictionary, the NumPy array, data frame, which are generally used for the numerical computation or machine learning related stuff. So those are the data structure that you will generally work on. What is the difference between machine learning and deep learning? Okay, we have already covered that. Okay, like XML, CSV, Excel, Notepad, DBMS. Yes, so yeah, Python supports data input from all this type of data sources. So finally, in the field of data science, is the data mat secure, as there is a lot of data which is also shared and modified easily? Definitely, security should not be the concern at all. Data science doesn't mean that you are compromising with the security or sensitivity of the data. Okay, so that is why organizations have got their internal data science or machine learning team, and data is not posted outside, but internally you work for your organization, for your business, without compromising with the data security. And you built and house application. That is why statistical programming languages Python and R are preferred rather than working on any cloud platform and sharing the data or loading the data on cloud. it takes me 8 to 10 hours to run a regression model for 100 plus variable, having 10,000 plus observation in SAS. So what about the Python? Hardik, very specific question. I would not be able to answer with all the accuracy. It actually depends on your environment as well, as I mentioned earlier. So cannot make that very generic statement about it. How symbolic learning is different from machine learning? Okay, so I'm not pretty much sure what exactly you mean by symbolic learning. Okay, but yeah, if it is traditional learning, then in machine learning you actually work on non-traditional programming, like any problem which can be solved with the help of traditional data structure. If you can decode anything, if you can decode any problem with the help of, for example, if else control structure, then that is not the problem of machine learning. Okay, so unnecessarily, if a problem can be solved by implementing some traditional control structure, unnecessarily we will not solve that problem with the help of machine learning. Machine learning cannot provide you always 100% accuracy. So if your problem can be solved with the traditional approach with 100% accuracy, go ahead with that option. Machine learning is the solution when you cannot solve your problem or you cannot make the prediction using the traditional programming. Okay, it will always give you less than 100% accuracy. Okay, how data science is helpful in IoT application? Basically, IoT is about data. So IoT is nothing but, devices are generating data, devices are connected with each other. So wherever it comes about data, data science is helpful. When it comes about IoT, you are basically talking about the sensor data, which is not that much easy to understand, that much easy to explore. So with the help of data science, I would say, understanding this type of machine generated data, sensor generated data, is very helpful. And rather than looking at the raw data, machine learning or data science can provide you better way to look at the data and make the conclusion. Okay. How can we improve model accuracy? So for improving model accuracy, you will have to improve your training. That is the only way you will improve your training. You will perform the parameter tuning during the model training. You will try the more appropriate data set. If your data is biased data, make it unbiased. If your parameter is not set to the proper setting, then perform the parameter tuning. And then in that way, you can increase your model accuracy. Okay, does the OpenCV and Keras support R? Yes, Keras support R, OpenCV. I never tried OpenCV in R, but there should be some way to implement OpenCV in R as well. I'm pretty much sure. But yes, Keras is yes. As a business analyst, how data science knowledge can help me achieve better? So, a business analyst, nowadays I have seen many examples where business analysts are getting involved directly with data science team, with data scientist, because the thing is, when it comes about the business knowledge, when it comes about understanding the problem from business point of view, the best person would be a business analyst only. Okay, if you have got little understanding or, basic level understanding of data science and machine learning, you can be the most important resource for your organization, because generally organization will face this type of challenge, where a business analyst is not good technically, okay, or the data scientist team does not have, that much business knowledge. So they will always look for a person who can work like a bridge. Okay, so if you are a business analyst and you have got some exposure to data science and machine learning approach, believe me, machine learning technologies, believe me, you will be the most precious resource of your organization. Okay, I want to be machine learning engineer. Should I learn first Python or math? For machine learning engineer, I would say you should give preference to Python programming first, and then secondary you can work on maths and stat, because as a machine learning engineer you will be supposed to work on data transformation, ETL, data integration stuff majorly. Okay, Okay, can I deploy models in other languages such as web application that use JavaScript? It is possible if you want to if you want to use some JavaScript, other scripting languages as well. But in turn, in that case, you will have to make a call to the script which can call your model built in Python or something. So APIs are nowadays are being used for that purpose. So that is pretty much possible. Okay. Can new programming languages like Kotlin be helpful here? So new programming languages are coming in market, but Python is already the leader, and it will take a lot of time for them to make their presence, to build that much support, online support, libraries and everything. So it is not the thing like you can launch a new product or launch a new statistical programming language over the night. Okay, so it takes time to build the community, to build the libraries, to build the packages and everything. Okay, what is data wrangling? So data wrangling is nothing but data pre-processing, cleaning the data, processing the data, making it in the form so that it can be used for your machine learning model purpose. In a mid-level experience in telecom industries, Python can enhance my growth. Definitely, if you would like to be in analytics, BI, and data science related background, data science related areas, then if you have an understanding of Python, you can be a good resource. You can be a good associate to your organization. Learning a new technology, a new thing, a latest thing will never harm you. Data metrics, data frame, data set, can you please explain your very big question, but I will keep it short. Data metrics is nothing but two-dimensional numeric entity, just like metrics. Only data frame on the other hand is a two-dimensional entity which have different data type for different column. On the other side, data set is a generic name used generically across all the platforms. In a statistical programming language, you call a data set as data frame only. Can a new programming language, I think, sir, how can we improve model accuracy? I think I have covered this. Can we say that referring to the data or business problem, we can know which model is to be used for advanced data analysis. So, for example, it is not only about business, but it is more about your data. Okay, your independent variables, for example, which are available for you. So for example, if you are working on a classification model, and more likely your target variable is depend on some probabilities. So maybe a probabilistic model like logistic regression, naive-Bayes, can be the better option as compared to the other classification approaches like SVM or KNN. So basically it depends on your data mainly. Can we modify our algorithm? You cannot modify the algorithm. Algorithms are standard algorithm, but either you can come up with your own algorithm, you can by building your own functions in Python, or you can customize already available algorithm by doing the parameter tuning. ITCS personnel with MBAs are better or only ITCS is fine? I would say an MBA person can be an added advantage, because if you have got some business knowledge, then definitely it would be an added advantage. Okay, but it is not like a comparison. Okay, so if for a data science role, for a data scientist role, MBA is optional, but it would be an added advantage if you have it already, because in that way you will be having good business knowledge. Okay, if we are going to have other meetings, please share the detail. Yes, Sunil, for sure. For that, you can get in touch with the Cognixia support team. I hope you already have the contact details. They will keep you updated. So please get in touch with the support team. I have good knowledge of PL, SQL and mathematics. Please suggest which language I need to learn for data science. Then you're very good. If you are already having PL, SQL and mathematics knowledge, then it is good time. It is the perfect time for you, Nitesh, to learn Python and gradually make your journey, start your journey towards data science and machine learning. I'm learning R more useful. iLearning are more useful over Python for data science. Yes, R is pretty much straightforward. I would not deny that as compared to Python, but you need to be ready for the future, okay? And you will see that latest trend, latest technology, especially in the field of deep learning, unstructured data handling, reinforcement learning, advancements are being done in Python more aggressively, okay? Since Swift is also being used in server-side programming languages, can it be useful in machine learning? I'm not sure if it is relevant. How different machine learning? I've covered this question. What type of data handling, pre-processing? So basically data pre-processing, data handling, we have different type of varieties. For example, we perform null data handling, categorical data handling, duplicate record handling, missing data imputation. So like training and test data, split data validation, distribution analysis of the data. So, you know, too many things are there. I think we cannot cover everything here. Can 3D data be also be implemented in data science like data frame? Like 3D data, for 3D data, we have, you know, n-dimensional array. So it is not represented in data frame, but we have n-dimensional array for that. Game development, you know, I do not find it relevant. Colleges in India to do the MSc. Sorry, I would not be able to help you with that information. How do we deal with streaming or real-time data? For streaming and real-time data, I won't say that, you know, exactly real-time data, but with the help of, you know, machine learning model deployed directly on the production, you can do next to or close to real-time analysis. I can install certain packages in R after all possible attempts. What should I do? Maybe you can try different mirrors in R, or maybe you can check for your R version. Or you can explicitly download the R package on your machine first and then install the package by providing the path to the package you have downloaded. Sunil has got some internet issue. You can get in touch with support team, Sunil. They will definitely help you if it is possible to get the recording. Everyone who is asking for the recording, please get in touch with Cognixia support team and you can get the recording if possible. Okay, sir, what is model ensembling? So basically, you know, there are some machine learning approaches which are not standalone machine learning models, but ensembling machine learning models. So basically, when you combine multiple machine learning models together to make the prediction one after another in sequential way, or when you iteratively use one algorithm again and again, like random forest, then it is known as ensemble machine learning approaches. Okay, Ashutosh, for further information of this type of webinar, please get in touch with Cognixia support team. They will help you with that, with the schedule and detail for sure. Image processing, for image processing, Dolly, we have OpenCV, we have, you know, neural network. So you can take, you can make use of OpenCV, you can make use of TensorFlow or Keras. Wendell is saying, enjoyed this webinar, very informative. Thank you, Wendell, and I really appreciate your positive feedback here. And you can definitely get in touch with the support team for further detail on the session and course related thing. As a field of research, can data science be taken over by machine learning and some universities provide a standalone course on machine learning? I would say yes. You know, if you have interest in specifically in machine learning, you can start your journey only in the fields of machine learning. That is also one approach. But as a holistic, if you really want to become a perfect data scientist, then you cannot ignore the remaining piece which are there apart from machine learning. Image-based learning and deep learning. So Dolly, image-based learning is one type of deep learning application. Apart from image processing, we also perform audio processing, video processing, like voice recognition, facial recognition, like you see on you know, Facebook, like, you know, multiple products like Alexa, you know, are being launched. They're all based on this type of unstructured and untraditional data processing, which can be made possible with the help of deep learning. Sunil, thanks for your comment. Sunil is saying you are number one. No, I'm not number one, but yeah, I'm trying to be better at my job. Okay. So related to internship program and jobs, so sorry, I would not be able to answer on this type of thing. Please ask your questions which are relevant to the context. How many days it will take to learn data science, I assume. So I would say data science is continuous journey, but with the with some guidance, with some professional course like Cognixia is going to provide you, you can fast track your learning path. So for detailed information about the course that we are going to launch in near future, like I think we are going to launch it in next couple of weeks only. So if you want any information about the course content, about the propaganda, about the course duration, topics, everything, please feel free to get in touch with the Cognixia support team. You can also go through the Cognixia website, so information is available online as well, and we will be happy to assist you about your questions and queries. Okay, Saurabh, thanks for your comment. Thanks, DRKVS, for your positive feedback. Okay, so I think we are already 30 minutes beyond the schedule. I'm sorry about that, but I really appreciate all of your efforts, all of your time, and for making this session a great success. And I really enjoyed all of your questions. Hope you all have enjoyed this session. Wish you all the best towards your journey. For your journey towards data science and machine learning, please keep in mind that it is going to require continuous effort. If you have already started the thing, please don't drop the thing in between because of the improper guidance or because of the absence of guidance and help and support. So we are here to help you. Please get in touch with Cognixia support team, and we will be able to provide answers or resolution to all of your queries and questions, and we can definitely provide you guidance in the fields of data science and machine learning. Okay, thank you all for the great comments from everyone. Have a very good night, a very good day for those who are in other time zone other than India. And I really enjoyed this session. I wish you all the best on behalf of Cognixia, and thank you all. Thank you, thank you, thank you, everyone. Thanks.